Welcome to Real Crusades History, the complete history of the Crusades series. Part 2, Christendom's Crucible, Survival, Endurance, Rebirth. Episode 3, The Overthrow of the Umayyads and the Christian Response. With the Berber revolt against the Arabs in 740, the Berber garrisons who held the northernmost frontiers of Al-Andalus were gone, leaving an opening for Christian advance. Alfonso I of Asturias gathered his army and reconquered Galicia. Meanwhile, all was not well in the heart of Islam either. In Damascus, the militant Kharijite sect, which had long ago rejected the Umayyads as corrupt, was gaining followers. Now a conspiracy was in place, masterminded by one Abu Muslim. Abu threw his support to the descendants of Muhammad's uncle Abbas and managed to raise an army, which marched under the black banners. By 750, this new Abbasid party had defeated the Umayyads, gaining control of the caliphate. Their first caliph was Abdullah, the bloodletter, so remembered by history for his grim determination to slaughter every last member of the Umayyad clan. In this he succeeded, although one escaped him, Abdurrahman, who fled to Spain and established an Umayyad caliphate in Cordoba. The Umayyads wouldn't be the only dispossessed dynasty of this period. Pepin the Short, now sole ruler of the Franks as mayor of the palace, sent Bishop Bouchard of Würzburg to Pope Zachary with a question. Should he allow the powerless Merovingian kings to keep their throne, or should he, the de facto ruler, assume the crown? Pope Zachary, drawing on the teachings of St. Augustine, replied, "It is better to give the name of king to him who possesses the power, rather than to him who does not, so that order can be preserved." Therefore, under papal authority, St. Boniface traveled to France and in 751 formally anointed Pepin as king of the Franks. Thus, the Carolingian dynasty overtook the Merovingian. Childeric III's long hair, a symbol of Germanic kingship, was shorn, and he was sent off to end his days in a monastery. Aware of the internal strife afflicting Islam, Pepin invaded the strip of southern French holdings of Al-Andalus in 752. Initially, he extracted tribute from the local lords, but by 759, he had annexed the whole of the region, conquering Narbonne. Also in 752, the Byzantines, under their young emperor Constantine V, won a grand victory over the Arabs, recapturing Theodosiopolis and Melitene. This, too, was the year that Pope Zachary died, replaced by Pope Stephen II, who found himself faced with the increased hostility of the Lombards of Italy. When the Lombard Aistulf threatened to march on Rome, the Pope sent an appeal for aid to the Byzantines and to Pepin of the Franks. While Constantine V ignored the Pope's plea, Pepin responded at once, crossing the Alps and defeating Aistulf easily in battle. Aistulf agreed to peace. Pepin's victory secured the Pope's sovereignty in the Papal States, which would endure for many centuries. Clearly, in the middle of the 8th century, Islam was on the defensive, Christendom taking the offense. But how long would this last? In the next episode, we'll explore Alfonso I of Asturias' biggest and boldest push against the Muslims yet. Thanks for watching. Please click on the subscribe button to get regular videos on Crusades history. If you enjoy Real Crusades history and wish to support our mission to provide great history, please click on the donate link in the About box to make a PayPal donation, or go to realcrusadeshistory.com and click on donate. Go to facebook.com/realcrusadeshistory to like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter @crusadeshistory.